The leader. K98 Talk is expanding its lineup for 2015. This means we are expanding our advertising base. Whether you're a startup trying to push through to the next level, or an established business trying to supplement your advertising budget, web-based advertising is a solid investment. Thanks to Talk's newest partnership with TuneIn Radio and instant access to our sister station, K98 FM, we give you worldwide access at a reasonable cost. Interested parties should email us at sales@k98fm.com. The leader in talk radio on the internet, right here on K98Talk.com.
Welcome to the podcast you've always wanted. It's The Right Angle with Bill and Leslie.
Hi, Bill.
Hi, Leslie.
There you are. I'm Leslie, and I'm back from vacation. Special thanks to our good friend PolitiBunny for filling in with Billy on a fantastic show last week so I could finish up getting tanned, rested, and ready. Later tonight, we're talking fake minimum wage increases, breaking anti-terror news out of Boston, and maybe a personal story from me in the Who Knew segment. But first, the answer to the question everybody's asking. Is it true, as Billy alleges, that I was drunk and covered in Vegemite while he and Bunny were taping last week's show? Bill, are you still going with that?
Yeah, but we didn't tape the show. The show was live.
And you taped it?
Yes.
Okay, yes. All right, while you were broadcasting last week, are you still going with that?
Yes.
Well, as appealing as Vegemite is, unfortunately for all of us, the answer is no. I was not drunk and covered in Vegemite. In fact, I was actually going through quite a traumatic event at that time, Bill, and I'd appreciate your sympathy.
Yeah.
Did you see my Facebook post?
No, I don't use Facebook. You know that.
Okay, well, I got to tell you what happened. Hang on, I'm just gonna read from it, because that's absolutely the most descriptive narrative of what happened to me last week. Okay.
Okay.
Ready? I am sitting on the United Airlines flight in the air, 30,000 feet above, and I am in tears of humiliation from discrimination. The flight attendant asked me what I would like to drink, and I requested a can of Diet Coke. She brought me a can that was open, so I requested an unopened can due to hygienic reasons, and she said, no Diet Coke for you.
That sounds familiar. A little bit.
Okay, obviously that wasn't me. Billy, who was that?
That was Tahera Ahmad. Ahmed. I know you're going to make fun of me for that.
That's it. Okay.
Diet Coke girl. Soda girl. By the way, if you're listening and you have Photoshop installed on your computer, your patriotic duty is to Photoshop a picture of this woman carrying a mattress-sized can of Coke.
Mattress-sized
Go ahead. I'll wait.
Can of Diet Coke.
I'll wait. Go ahead. So, of course, she's a social justice warrior who is a Muslim, and she's on a United Airlines flight, which may or may not have even existed. And clearly she was at 30,000 feet. And she asked the stewardess to give her a can of soda. And they brought her an open can of soda. And she said, well, you guys can't do that because I'm a crackpot and I need one that's not opened. So they basically said, well, no, we're not going to give you an unopened can of soda. To which she said...
Oh, I gotta get back. Damn it. Sorry, wait. So let me catch up. This is dramatic reading night. Sorry. So I asked her again why she refused to give me an unopened can of Diet Coke. And she said, we are unauthorized to give unopened cans to people because they may use it as a weapon on the plane.
That is not true. The anybody who's ever flown on a plane, and I've only ever flown on a plane twice, anybody who's ever flown on a plane once in their life who's ever gotten a soda from the flight attendants by the grace of God knows why it is that they do this. Do you know the reason why that they don't give you they give you an unopened can of soda?
I just figured that it's apportioning across their entire fleet of planes.
No, it's a serving thing. If you go into a restaurant, right, and you ask them for a can of soda, a lot of your fancier places, they'll open the can and they'll pour half of it into the glass with some ice for you.
Uh huh.
It's a customer service thing. It's not a weapon thing.
Oh, okay.
There's no such policy on United, and there's no such policy on any airline. Even the Israeli airlines don't do that. It's a customer service thing. They bring the can out, they open it in front of you, and then they pour it for you. They pour like a half a glass of soda, and then you do the rest yourself. But it's like a customer service thing. And so this woman got really, really, really heated about this. And she had obviously a lot to say about it, because as I'm scanning through the hundreds of thousands of Facebook posts from her, it's pretty clear that she has a lot to say about this too. But the best part of all of this is the dialogue that she wrote for the American passengers on the plane who apparently harassed her.
Can I continue?
Yeah, go ahead.
So I told her that she was clearly discriminating against me because she gave the man next to me an unopened can of beer. She looked at his can, quickly grabbed it and opened it and said, it's so you don't use it as a weapon. Appalled at her behavior, I asked people around me if they witnessed the discriminatory and disgusting behavior. And the man sitting in an aisle across from me yelled out to me.
I can't even read this without laughing. I tried doing this last night for Chelsea Elisa on Twitter, and I literally cannot do this without laughing.
Do it.
You Muslim, you need to shut the fuck up.
I said, what?
Yes, you know you would use it as a weapon, so shut the up. This is absolutely look. If this is the best that I've done a lot about this on Twitter the last day or two. I have a great deal to say about this as well as I'm sure you do. But one of the things that I would say about this that really comes to my mind is that this woman is probably not – she's probably a very honest person in her real life, because no one could concoct a story willingly that is this fucking terrible and not be a first-time liar.
I have so
much – This is clearly the first time that this woman has ever done this, probably the last, because – this story is so concocted out of nothing. First off, it's not a policy that the cans can be used as weapons. Second, who do you know in America or anywhere in this world born in the last 70 years uses the phrase Muslim? MOSLEM. My grandfather used that. He was born in 1934. I don't know anyone born in the last 50 years that says that.
That doesn't even make any sense anyway, because it's just her writing down what she allegedly heard out of this guy's mouth. Why would she spell it that way? Because that's the thing. She spelled it M-O-S-L-E-M.
Well, when people say,
that's not how she spells it.
That's
how she spells Muslim.
When people say Muslim, I'm saying it the correct way. That's how it's pronounced, Muslim. So if she were to have heard that, if she were to have ever heard that word in her life, she would know how it sounds, because it doesn't sound like Muslim. It's Moslem. It's pretty clear it's a different word. But that's not even my point. My point is that this word is something that's been out of the lexicon in this country, mm-hmm. indeed in the world, for 50 years now. No one says that anymore. It's an old word, a very old word. And then the other thing is, how many Americans do you know that don't talk in contractions? Besides Brent Spiner on Star Trek TNG. No, seriously, how many Americans do you know that don't talk in contractions?
Nobody.
You need to shut the F up. I said, what? He then leaned over from his seat, looked me straight in the eyes, and said, yes, you know you would use it as a weapon, so shut the up. Use it as a weapon. I mean, it just seems to me like this was written...
concocted. It's completely concocted. And let me tell you something, Bill, and I know we're going to talk further about what little we know about this lady, and I wish that I wish I had more time before the show to learn more about her. But whereas I agreed with you the other day, it does seem like this is a bad lie made up by somebody who is typically a super honest person. As I learn more about her, the fact is that she is basically your typical social justice warrior, Marxo feminist.
That doesn't mean that she's necessarily a liar, though. The construction of this story, you can only determine one of two things. She's either completely retarded, or this is the first time she's ever tried to do something like this. Because anyone who'd ever done something like this before would have learned from their mistakes. Because I promise you, Americans and humans in general talk in contractions.
No, I don't disagree that this is the first time she tried to do something like this on this scale. And part of my kind of thesis about this, Bill, is that she's looking around at the fame and infamy that is being gained by other people portraying themselves as victims and martyrs. And by the way, my term for her is soda martyr. And I got this from the, no Diet Coke for you. Out soup Nazi in soda martyr. I think like she got into this situation because at the end of the day, this is just shitty service. She got shitty service from a shitty flight attendant. And she said, this is my chance to become a martyr in social media. Here's my chance. I haven't had something big happen for me since I got my picture taken with the president.
That's what I think. Yeah, for the Secretary of State.
Oh, him too?
Yeah, she had pictures taken with both of them.
Yeah, okay. So
it's the thing about her. Okay, so let's just go on and read some more of this. let's do it without the accent, though.
I'm doing it with the accent.
I want to highlight something specifically that she said here. I am truly disappointed at the latest statement by United Airlines. Unfortunately, United has dismissed my entire narrative.
Mm-hmm.
Narrative. Why would she use that word? Why wouldn't it? Because if you think about it, the issue, if it occurred the way that she explains it, it's not a narrative. It's poor customer service training. It's not necessarily racist.
It's my complaint. They've dismissed my complaint about their poor service. But you can't call it that.
Well, a narrative sort of indicate, and then you know, and then she kind of falls apart. And so, is there anything particular you want to read from this before we really jump into this? Because there is one other thing I want to read from this.
I had two other things I want to read from the one that you just mentioned. Again, dismissed my entire narrative and trivialized it. I just want to highlight that again, first of all, because this is laden with social justice, progressive code speak for something that's trying to take the place of what it is, which is a customer service.
Yeah, you're talking about the later post, right?
Yeah, well, no, this one, but then another one. But yeah, my entire narrative. She can't just say dismissed my complaint, because it's not a complaint to her. It's an epic story of a struggle.
Wow.
Of an existential
the
fucking
epic
struggle.
Epic of Gilgamesh.
Right, right. But then, so then the other thing is, you know, it is ridiculing to my integrity to dismiss the discriminatory behavior towards me. I have dedicated my life to peace. In fact, I was on this United flight to promote social justice activism, just and peaceful conversations between Israelis and Palestinians at Kids for Peace. I was on the flight to promote social justice activism.
And I guess she ended up doing that, didn't she?
She sure as fuck did. Sure did. In a way that she never could have done at that peace whatever the hell it was, Kids for Peace conference. Now is my chance.
Yeah, the part that I find absolutely stunning from this, and the part that I continue to recite on Twitter and show to people, is this part here. It's in the same post. The pilot also apologized for everything that had happened and said that as a white male, he recognized his privilege and said he didn't know what it must feel like to be a minority and go through something hateful like this. He then walked me off the flight to the customer service desk and helped me file an official complaint.
Bullshit. This is just bullshit.
Are you fucking kidding me?
No, there's
like,
absolutely
really?
No way.
So, a pilot, a guy who probably graduated from college, who's, you know, probably in his 40s, maybe older.
Maybe a military veteran.
Possibly a military veteran. Knows what the phrase white privilege means. Now I asked her on Twitter specifically. I said, look, I have only one question about this entire thing, and I will never ask you another question again. And it is as follows. When the pilot apologized to you and talked to you, did he use the word white privilege? Did he use that phrase to you, white privilege? Did he at any time in the conversation say the words white privilege or privilege in the conversation?
Uh-huh. The answer is?
Crickets.
Crickets.
Yeah, basically crickets. No answer. Nobody home.
No. Of course not.
And that's the most telling part, isn't it? The part where she says, well, he recognized his privilege. I have to promise you that anyone who is an airline pilot doesn't fucking know what white privilege is.
Absolutely
let alone recognize
not.
It if you explained it to them.
Absolutely
I
not.
Can't even understand it. I was a liberal for 20 years. I can't even fucking understand it.
And I really don't believe there's any airline pilot who just, you know, who every day has to get hundreds of people safely up into the air, defying gravity and down. And there's a customer service problem. No pilot's going to be talking about his race and the person's race and whatever. They'd be talking about the person's complaint.
I will say that when the plane lands, the pilot does say goodbye to you at the, you know, when you get off the plane, and that's probably what she was talking about. No, seriously. I really think the flight is United Air 3504. The person who flew this plane has to be someplace. Okay? this guy has to be somewhere. And if anybody who listens to this knows somebody who works for United, can figure out who this pilot is, I would love to talk to them. Because that is the question that is on my mind. Did he use the phrase privilege, and did he say white privilege to her? Because I promise you $1,000 that he didn't. I would bet my life on it.
Of course not. And then that's the other thing, at least as of when we were looking into this story today, there is no independent corroboration from anybody.
Yeah.
Her story, except for United's public statements. There aren't any other passengers that came forward. There aren't any other crew members that have made any statements, right? It's just this Facebook, the soda martyr.
The statement that United made was the flight attendant on board America Flight 3504 attempted several times to accommodate her beverage request after a misunderstanding regarding a can of diet soda. The in-flight crew met with her after the flight arrived in Washington to provide assistance and further discuss the matter. Additionally, we spoke with her this afternoon to get a better understanding of what occurred and apologize for not delivering the service our customers expect when traveling with us. We look forward to having an opportunity to welcome her back. That's what they said.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, because she made a complaint. She made a complaint. She raised the stink on the plane. The in-flight crew talked to her after disembarking started, whatever they call it. Mm-hmm. And that was it. That was basically where they considered the matter squashed. Now, as for her saying, well, the captain helped me get to, I don't know, a safe space, a place to file the complaint. It may be possible that the pilot was there at the time that she disembarked from the plane, and he said, well, if you want to file a complaint, you just go up the hallway here and go straight down the hall and then make another right and then take the elevator down one floor and then take the tram across the
property. He was probably walking up like the jetway with her at the same time anyway.
Yeah, he was probably taking his duffel bag.
He had his own coat and his own luggage, and he was just walking up, and she's still bitching. And
Yeah, exactly.
I gotta get this chick off me.
Yeah, you know what you do? You make a left, a right, another left, down one floor, then take the tram across to the other side of the airport, and then you go over to Gate C, and you tell Mr. Tunney over there that he needs
to
file a complaint, okay? And you tell him that you're a friend of mine, all right? For the fucking bar.
Here, take these wings. Look, I have this nice set of plastic.
You ever have a pilot's hat, man? Come on, I got some fucking tape badges in my locker. You want them?
These gold-plated plastic wings, they're in a hermetically sealed plastic bag. Totally hygienic.
Look, I got some TSA badges in my locker that have been missing for like 3 months from the TSA in Baltimore and in Washington. I'll give them to you right now. You just can't tell them that I'm the one that stole the 850 badges from them. Some of them might even be hermetically sealed. I don't know. Hey, tell you what, here's the key to my Jag. Go get them.
I don't know about that.
Yeah, I mean, but it's like, dude, come on, go away. Just go away. Leave me alone.
There is one more dramatic reading I want you to do before we move on here. Oh, the unsafe space. This is not about a can of soda. I was really hoping that after speaking with me, they would have publicly acknowledged their lack of consistency in following procedure, because no large company has lack of consistency in customer service, right? And accusations which led to hateful words and the unfortunate lack of bystander intervention, nor the flight attendant's attempt to intervene and prevent further disrespect, which created an unsafe space for me. Unsafe space is another SJW. SJW. I always get that confused with Sarah Jessica Parker. But,
well, I'll tell you what, I was looking at the cover of the new Vanity Fair magazine yesterday, and I got something confused for Sarah Jessica
Parker. I was just going to say, but enough about Caitlyn Jenner. I don't actually see that, but I see Jessica Lange. But anyway, so yeah, once again, it's SJW speak for her narrative. Literally, she called it her own narrative, and I'm out of my mind about this. And here's why I'm, among many reasons, I'm so pissed off, because this is who our government is elevating. She's a chaplain. She's recognized as a leading female Muslim by the White House. This is who is a Muslim?
Did you see the Quranic recitation competition she went to?
Yep.
Okay, so you saw the comment by her that she went to this, for people who don't know, she went to this competition where men generally recite verses from the Quran in kind of a sing-songy kind of way. And Arabic, it's supposed to be a beautiful language. I don't know.
Hey!
So only men are allowed to compete in this competition, but from pressure like social justice warriors like her, they have started allowing women to compete. And so she posted on Twitter that this competition where she was allowed to go and represent like the United States for women was a great chance for her to mingle and share in the diversity of Islam and blah, blah, blah. And she mingled with only women, because men and women don't compete together, and they're not allowed to talk to each other during the competition.
Very progressive.
So this woman who is basically barking like a little chihuahua at the heels of everybody in the war in the United States about, you know, progressivism and shit like that, goes to a competition where she's a third class citizen and doesn't say anything about it.
Right, and she's proud of that. She's the leading Muslim female, according to the White House. But of course, it's not because of that. It's because of this. It's because of this part of her identity that she's a progressive feminist SJW. Otherwise, nobody would look at her. Nobody would look at her. This is what's making me bonkers beyond anything else. You have Ayaan Hirsi Ali, who we all know who she is. We all know what she's suffered in her life, female genital mutilation, terror, every like injustice upon women that Islam inflicts upon women, she has suffered. She's a refugee of Islam. She's a true feminist, and by the way, an atheist. And she is shunned by the left in this country, including this chick, including Tahira Ahmed, retweeted a call to deny an honorary degree to Ayaan Hirsi Ali. So how much of a leading Muslim female are you? Like, are you a reformer? Or do you support?
She just kind of seeks her own level.
Exactly. Like now's my chance. Cause she's a chaplain. Yeah. Can you be a female Muslim chaplain? I don't know. What mosque recognizes her?
Well, none, because women can't be imams. So.
Okay, how about that?
I mean, she's a chaplain at a university, at a lefty university, which condones that sort of thing.
Right.
I'm sure they have some gay, black, Jewish, Muslims there too or something. But that doesn't mean that Islam as a whole accepts her. She's a big fish in a little pond.
Yeah, and you know?
She's the token acceptable Muslim at this school, and
and at the White House.
Yeah,
and that's what's driving me crazy about this whole thing. It's basically your typical victim, leftist feminist victim who's going to find a way to be oppressed under any circumstances to give herself the limelight, to give herself a social advantage, covered up in a hijab and doused in, a carbonated artificially sweetened package.
Speaking of artificially sweetened packages, I think it's time for our first break.
Time for a break. Coming up after this, we are talking about, oh, more artificially sweetened minimum wage increases. See you soon.
What do I do when my love is away?
Does it worry you to be alone?
No, no. How do I feel at the end of the day?
Are you sad 'cause you're on your own?
I tell you, don't say it no more.
We will never fully understand what we've asked of our military service members or their families, asking them to put themselves in harm's way, to endure it all. But we do understand that it's our turn, our duty, to keep them secure for the rest of their lives. Wounded Warrior Project long-term support programs help our most severely ill or injured veterans live independently, at no cost, for life, so that they might stand at ease. Join us at findwwp.org.
Red Nation Rising brings you Town Hall Radio.
From a single tweet to 3 million a month, our community is a force to be reckoned with on social media.
So don't miss our show, Thursdays, 8 p.m. Eastern on K98 Talk.
Our chat room is our co-host, and you ask the question.
Join us and be heard.
So get ready to sound off on Red Nation Rising Radio. No one else is going to do it for you.
And we're back with the podcast you have always wanted, and I've always wanted to do. That's my creepy Tom Shalhoub voice. I like it.
Sounds good.
How did you take that out again? I didn't hear that.
Artificially sweetened
minimum wage promises. Artificially sweetened. There's nothing sweet about unions, but there sure is a lot of artificial to them, isn't there?
Yeah, they suck.
Unions have been pushing the fight for 15, the fight to get minimum wage slobs with no high school degrees who work at the age of 40 at McDonald's $15 an hour. That doesn't sound right, does it?
No.
Does anybody in the world think that the guy that wraps your hamburger and shoves it into a fucking paper bag at McDonald's, like a drunk man on the street puts a bottle in a bag, does anybody actually think that those guys deserve the same money an hour that an EMT or maybe a satellite dish installer gets?
I know who does.
Who?
Union bosses.
That's right. Specifically, AFL-CIO union boss Richard Trumka. Richard Trumka has been using the AFL-CIO for 2 years now to glom off of the Occupy Wall Street movement, the jerk-offs from Madison, Wisconsin, Bloombergville, and now Black Lives Matter. He says that everyone deserves a fair shake in America for shaking some salt on French fries. But there's a catch to this, as is always the case when you get into bed with the unions. As the automakers found out in the early days of the last century, there's always a catch. What's the catch to this one, do you think?
What's yours is mine.
What's yours is mine. But not necessarily. Because What's yours belongs to the unions, but what's the unions doesn't belong to you. That's right. The Los Angeles City Council voted in an overwhelming majority to enact a $15 an hour minimum wage for the city of Los Angeles. Great. But there's a catch. The catch is the unions don't want part of it. They don't want any of it. Not the $10 an increase that's coming next year, or the $11 an increase that's coming the year after that. Oh, that's right. The minimum wage increase in Los Angeles, like Seattle, San Francisco, and everywhere else, has a catch. The catch is they don't take effect for years. San Francisco's increase in minimum wage won't take effect until 2019. The increase in Los Angeles's minimum wage won't take effect until 2018. And Democrat candidate Martin O'Malley, who is using the fact that he fought vigorously for a minimum wage increase in the state of Maryland for the city of Baltimore, the increase that he earned to $15 an hour for residents of Maryland and people who live in the city of Baltimore, it won't take effect until 3 fucking years after he's elected president, assuming he's elected.
Yeah, that'll happen.
Yeah, well, that's a campaign promise.
Let me back you up one second, because there's so much bullshit here, like, as usual, when you talk about unions and wages, that my head is spinning. There's three friggin' problems that you've already outlined, right? There's one is that, of course, the unions
are scumbags.
Well, yes. So the unions push for higher minimum wage because, and as anybody would intuitively know, they get a percentage of union members' wages.
Yes. Now that's an important thing. A lot of people will say, the Black Lives Matter crowd will say, people need wage increases. They need to make $15 an hour. They have to support their families. It'll keep one of the arguments that people from Black Lives Matter have made on Twitter and on television, D. Ray McKesson has made this argument many times on TV, is that a living wage will actually keep black families together and it will keep them out of trouble. So if only Trayvon Martin had $15 an hour and a union to take four of those dollars every month, every week,
you never hear that
part.
Yeah, but you never hear that part.
Well, of course you won't hear it because it sucks.
Right. Okay. So
I was a member of a union. They pay you $12 and then they'll take three fucking dollars every week, every day out of your paycheck.
Okay, so that's shitty part number one. So then number two, you're saying even though that's sort of the typical model, now in LA, unions, after having done
people
all of the
people
work,
who are wondering, I was a member of AFSCME, AFSCME. I worked for the United States Postal Service.
Are you asking me or are you telling?
No,
me?
That's the name of the union.
Are you asking me or
No. I'm not doing a who's on first thing.
Okay. you already did it. I got you. So, all right. So then the second part is that the unions in LA, after trying to push through the minimum wage increase, are now looking for their own exemption from it.
But what is the exemption that they want from it? Pray.
Tell me.
Well, the unions have basically coerced the city council of Los Angeles, who are mostly progressives and Democrats, into voting for this, wage increase, which, by the way, has only passed the city council. It's not law yet. It's not law until it's actually written into a proclamation and an amendment to the charter of the city, and then they vote on it again. So it's actually just a bullshit vote.
Bill, yeah.
So
what's the exemption?
What happened? Well, I'm telling you. So they had this meeting where it's a call for comments, and the union bosses came up and said, well, we would like to be exempted from the increase. And the city council was like, well, why? And they were like, well, it'll help us build membership. So the way that we're thinking this could work is we would be businesses that unionize or hire unions to come into their businesses would be exempt from the law. And so the majority reaction from the city council was like, bitch, you got to be kidding me.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you made us do all of this. You said it was going to be great for workers. Now y'all motherfuckers want out? Like, what? Well, then, so what happened? Now let's go into a perfect union world and say everybody, they were successful at unionizing every business in the city of Los Angeles.
Mm-hmm.
So does that mean then that everybody would... See, the thing is that they want everybody, they want shops that unionize, businesses that unionize, or places that invite unions in, they want them to be able to pay people according to the old standard, the old agreed upon standard for the city, which is $9.25, which is pretty damn, it's a lot lower than $15.
Right.
And... it just sort of highlights the fact that this was basically a recruiting drive for the unions all along. And this is.
Well, yeah, and that's what I was just about to ask. Like, what is the strategy here for the unions?
Well, the strategy is that, you ever see that? You ever watch the game show Price is Right?
Of course.
Well, it's like squeeze play. You're going to squeeze them from the left, and the unions will squeeze mm-hmm. them from the right, and the business owners will go, I give up! And then, you know, the businesses will unionize, and they'll pay their workers $9 an hour.
Yes.
And the people who don't will go out of business.
I don't know. I think I don't think they have it. They're act together that much. I think it's more along the lines of what you were saying just before, is that it's, you know, sort of a recruiting drive for the unions to support the higher minimum wage, because then the workers see the workers who are about to be all fired see, oh hey, well, wherever I go next, I definitely want to be involved in a union. I want to join a union because they'll take care of me. But then on the other hand, the unions have their bargaining chip with businesses. I don't know. I don't know if I would call it a squeeze play. I'd almost call it a diversity play, a diversification.
Okay. I would call it a scam.
Well, yeah, hell yeah. And you know what? It's kind of remarkably, speaking of Trumpka, akin to how they were crazy supportive of Obamacare to begin with, until Obamacare started affecting them directly. And then Trumpka it wasn't going his way. It wasn't going their way. And he was very outspoken against it.
Yeah. Because it's sort of like a Jimmy Stewart thing. Well, I got to pay for that. Like, you know, like, no, Grice didn't tell me I had to pay for that. I'm not doing that.
Yeah.
So
it's going to be interesting. I don't see this going ahead.
Well, it'll probably go ahead without the exception.
That's what I mean. I don't think the exemption will be.
Oh, yeah. No, I don't think they're going to give it to them at all. In fact, I watched a news clip of one L.A. city councilman who describes himself as a democratic socialist, said he was absolutely offended that the union would even ask them to do this.
Mm-hmm.
So I think they're going to get the wage increase over time. And that's the thing, right? They celebrate about these things, but they're just temporary victories. Yeah. Like, if the city council amended the wages to $15 an hour by the year 2020, well, what the hell is to stop somebody else from reversing it?
Right. Oh, and then that's the part three of the shitty stuff, because part one was crap. I don't even remember. What the hell did we say was the part one? Unions get a piece of the higher wages. Part two was that now they want the exemption for themselves. Part three is the artificially sweetened wages, which is that all of these promises include and all these increases, including what O'Malley is basing his presidential campaign on, they don't exist yet.
Yeah, and they won't for years. And that's sort of the motto, isn't it? Kick the can forward.
Kick the can administration and Operation Kick the Can. Everything is promised the love now and the good feeling now, and the pain comes after there's nothing you can do about it. Or after I, your savior, am long gone.
This is true.
All right. Well, that was fun. We are heading into a break. When we come back, breaking anti-terror news out of Boston, and Who Knew, also known as?
I shit you not.
We'll be right back.
The leader in talk radio on the internet, right here on K98Talk.com.
JD.
And this is Stacy.
Join us Tuesday night, 10 p.m. Eastern, for Game On. Remember,
lock up the children and the old folks.
Game On, the home of libertarians and conservatives.
Where no one is safe, no one is spared, not even the hosts.
Oh, that was supposed to be a spin cycle. I'm sorry.
Yeah, that's okay. We love you anyway. Right round, baby.
Self-monitoring
right round.
Ebola
anyway.
Radio strikes again.
Anyway.
Anybody see the host monkey? Today. Where's the host monkey? Where's the host monkey? For God's sake, I need an antidote. Just
anyway,
do your rant. Let's pop out of the cycle.
Has to do with
Find us on Twitter at JD and Stacy.
You're listening to K98Talk.com.
And we're back. Do Black Lives Matter? I know one that doesn't anymore.
Right, well.
At 7 a.m., Usama Rahim, I kid you not, that is his name, was shot and killed by an agent of the Joint Terrorism Task Force. Why was Mr. Rahim dead, as Jesse Jackson would say. Mr. Rahim is dead because Mr. Rahim is a terrorist fuck. He had connections to the Islamic State, and he was under 24-hour surveillance by the Joint Terrorism Task Force, the FBI, the Department of Homeland Security, and three other parts of the alphabet soup that I don't remember. Two police officers and an agent of the FBI approached him, looking to talk to him, and as is always the case with terrorists, he pulled out a 12-inch knife and said, and so they shot him. And now he's dead.
And where did this happen?
It happened in Boston, Massachusetts, outside of a CVS in the Roslindale neighborhood.
Yeah,
shot him in broad fucking daylight, right in front of a bunch of kids getting on a school bus.
I don't know about that being funny, but I can tell you that pulling out a 12-inch knife around here in front of law enforcement is really frowned upon. This is the same state that you need a license. You need like a state license to carry pepper spray. Everything is a weapon here.
Especially 12-inch long Bowie knives.
Mm-hmm.
Look, this guy had connections to ISIS. He was under watch. He was on a watch list. He was on actually three of them. He didn't get there by mistake. His brother... Now, I bet everybody's wondering, why did I say the Black Lives Matter thing? Well, it's because his brother, Ibrahim, isn't that an awesome name? It rhymes.
It's like Sirhan Sirhan.
Yes, it rhymes.
Ibrahim Rahim.
It rhymes. He's black. Now his life doesn't matter. His brother went on Facebook and posted that his brother was an innocent Muslim, or Muslim, depending on who's writing the script.
Depending on if you're on a United...
Depending on which plane you're on. And he was simply standing at a bus stop, waiting to go to work, talking to his beloved father on the phone, when he was cruelly shot in the back three times by police officers from the Boston Police Department. That's not good. But Mr. Rahim's last words were, "I can't breathe."
I don't buy that.
Why would you? Why would anybody?
And again, this
the only way this could have been better if he said, "Hands up, don't shoot."
And then his hands were up, yeah.
And then that's how the knife got raised up at the cop. Hold on, hands up, don't. Oh! You shot me, you fucking guy.
Oh my god.
Sorry.
iTunes. No, I don't know. I like it better when I do the Arab impersonations than when you
Mine was
do.
More like an Indian guy, but I'm not really sure how to impersonate a black man who speaks perfect Arabic who's lived in Sudan.
I don't think you should try.
I'm not going to. It would be vaguely racist of me.
But yeah, but so that the is when we last saw or when I last saw the allegation that his last words were "I don't breathe" were according to his brother's social media post. I can't breathe.
Yes, it's purely from his brother. And one of the things now that I want to mention about the brother is that his brother is a welfare jockey. I thought that would be interesting.
The
living brother. He is the imam of his mosque. A mosque, which apparently he has made extremely wealthy with his oration skills. That's according to his Facebook post. That is not something that I made up, and it's not a cunning linguist joke either.
It is now.
It is now. That's what she said. But yes, his brother went on Facebook 3 months ago and posted a picture of the line that he had to wait on at the unemployment and welfare office in his town.
Yep.
I played the smallest violin for him. Isn't that so much like every terrorist that's ever been killed in the United Kingdom? Every single one of them we find out is living in a palatial house on government money, and their family is on every form of public assistance known to man, and they're getting a really sweet house to live in, and blah, 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 blah.
Well, I don't know about the UK, but, you know, as, again, a Massachusetts resident, this is so shades of the Boston Bombers to me. And you know I don't say their names. They're only Flashbang and Speed Bump. It's just totally shades of them. Same crap.
I prefer to call the small one electrocuted now.
Whatever.
Cardiac arrest.
I like to not call refer to them at all, but it's just
pretty soon he won't be able to breathe either.
Okay. On that note, I'm not going to have time to tell the whole Who Knew story. I was going to tell that this the very personal story about how the one time that I, your humble co-host, pulled the Middle East race card with the authorities. But we're going to have to save that for another time. I'll give you the little short version of who knew, another personal story where the reason that I feel comfortable doing dramatic readings in an irate female Arabic accent is, of course, because I'm personally of Middle Eastern descent, and I have many, many family members and friends whose inspiration I draw upon to do these performances. But I will say that one funny little known fact about me that you may know if you follow me on Twitter is that with my beloved ex-boyfriend, the father of my dog, Nar, and I were what, who is also Lebanese and West African, we were once going to open up a halal butcher shop and convenience store, and we were going to call it Holy Cow.
Wow.
I shit you not.
Yeah, halal is some filthy stuff. So.
Hey!
That's very nice.
I was going to make millions on that, infidel. Anyway.
Yes.
All right. Well, we need to sign out, Billy. Tell everybody where they can find you, especially now.
I am on Twitter at Defend Wall Street, and I am currently playing The Witcher 3 on Xbox One. And if you don't have that game, you are a fucking loser. Go get it. I'll wait.
Wow. And I am at L.A. Dowd on Twitter. You can hear me pre-recorded on the Snark Factor with Fingers Malloy, as well as on the Midnight Movie Cowboys podcast. And I was a guest on last week's Midnight Movie Cowboys epic, epic podcast review of Mad Max Fury Road, which was a big deal for them because, as our listeners know, their Australian co-host, Stuart, was actually here visiting the States, and we recorded the episode right here in my humble abode. And it's very not safe for work and very funny. Anything else, Billy?
Nope, I'm good.
All right,
Witcher 3.
Big thanks to all of our Politainment and K98 Talk friends. Big thanks to Ricky the Love Bug Robinson for producing our show, as always. And we'll catch you all next week. Living on the edge.